You know, there is nothing more important for the Christian than to have a genuine relationship with his Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing. Nothing. And you know, we all know how we would like that relationship to be. But do we ever consider how Christ would like that relationship to be? Brethren, we're going to look at an awesome passage of Scripture this morning that deals with a lot of topics, not just that one. And I'm not going to necessarily be commenting on the relationship with Christ, but Christ will be in this passage. Would you listen to it carefully and please get from it everything you can? Because it's a very beautiful passage of Scripture. It's found in John's Gospel, chapter 17. If you'll turn there with me, please. John's Gospel, chapter 17. You know, some have said that chapters 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17 of this gospel are quite likely the richest passage in Scripture. Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning for Jesus, your grace, all that God you've provided for our lives. And I pray that, Father, this morning, as we look again to your wonderful word, God, that always illuminates us, God, and shows us the way. Faithfully, God, and truthfully, and God gives us everything, God, we need to live for Jesus and stay living for Jesus. That, God, this morning, as we look again to the Word, God, it will have meaning for each of us, God. So that, God, the relationship we have with your Son might be improved, might take a step up, become, God, what Jesus wants it to be. In Jesus' name we ask it, Father. Bless us richly through your Word we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, what we're going to look at this morning is what has been called the real Lord's Prayer. In other words, it was spoken by Jesus the night before he died. Concerning it and this 17th chapter that contains it, Bengel wrote that this of all chapters in Scripture is the simplest in words and the deepest in meaning. And indeed it is. It allows you to see Jesus as perhaps you've never seen him before. In fact, as Irwin says, it allows you to look into the very heart of Christ. So let's look at it together, beginning at verse number 1. These words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. Now, when Christ said here that the hour has come, he meant for him to step forward to his greatest mission on this earth. His date with the cross. Therefore he prays, glorify thy Son, or make him victorious through death. Raise him back to life, and let him be acknowledged as the Savior of the world. That thy Son also, he continues, may glorify thee, by making it possible through his death for God to become the universal Father of all mankind. Now, right from the start, this prayer abounds with proof that Jesus is divine. Brother, no mere human could have ever prayed, Father, glorify me, that in turn I might glorify you. Right, as Jesus continues to pray, with all of the assurance that he is divine, he says this in verse number 2, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him, or to as many as have a heart after God, and who God through his Spirit led to Jesus. Now, Christ's power over all flesh, all people, can be seen by the fact that he alone is their creator, their redeemer, and their judge. If Christ doesn't rule you, as Matthew Henry said, he will overrule you. And as for the eternal life that he gives us, just as much as it's longer than this life, it is more wonderful than this life. And how is it obtained? Look at verse number 3. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, who is always to be distinguished from the false gods of the heathen, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent, who alone can bring us to the Father. Let me add something here. A very popular argument of the Calvinist is, if God gives us everlasting life, he can't take it back. What they fail to realize is this. Eternal life isn't a gift by itself. It comes packaged in the person of Jesus. Christ said that himself. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Therefore, in describing Jesus, 1 John 5:20 states that this is the true God and eternal life, which means Jesus is God and Jesus is life. Amen. Now, if we depart from the living God, as Hebrews 3:12 warns us not to do, do we still have life? How can we? 1 John again tells us that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Therefore, and listen carefully, he that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. So as Christ and eternal life come as one, they leave as one. Verse number 4. I have glorified thee in the earth by a sinless life and vicarious death. And though he hadn't gone to the cross yet, it was so sure of doing that. He speaks of it here as though it had already been done. Notice, I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. Now, commenting on Christ's testimony here, Goddard wrote that this verse expresses with a sublime frankness the feelings of a conscience perfectly pure. Jesus, in this supreme moment of his life, perceives no evil committed, nor any good neglected. The duty of every day has been completely fulfilled. There has been in his human life, which he now leaves behind him, neither stain nor omission. Therefore he prays in verse number 5, And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. In other words, he was praying, Father, make me again equal to yourself. Set me again on my throne and return to me everything I forfeited to become a man. Remember in verse number 4, he had glorified his Father on earth. And for this he knew his Father would glorify him in heaven. Likewise, we too. Brethren, we must serve God in this world for God to reward us in the next one. All right, to this point, Jesus has prayed for himself. He next begins to pray for his disciples. Verse number 6. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Now, to manifest God's name means that he made God knowable by his teachings, by his example. Matthew 11:27 tells us that no man knows the Father except he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. And to whom did he reveal them? He tells us here, unto the men which thou gavest me, notice, out of the world. Which strongly implies that for God to give us to Jesus, he must first extract us from the world. In other words, for Jesus to possess us, the world no longer can. Okay, he next says, thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. And that, brethren, is the earmark of every true Christian. Listen, compromisers go where compromisers preach, but the uncompromised keep God's word, which means they observe it and they obey it. Now that alone keeps them bonded to Jesus and detached from the world. Verse number 7, now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee, for I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them. Now, Christ is going to lay a lot of stress on God's word in this prayer. So notice first that it came from the Father through Jesus to his disciples. And because, as he says here, they received it, they didn't reject it like the world does, they received it. Look at the positive results this had, and have known surely, he says. They've got no doubts at all. They know surely that I came out from thee, that my origin is divine, and they have believed. They don't question this at all, that thou didst send me. Therefore, that my mission is a divine one. And that's what God's word does, brethren. It enables us to know with the greatest of assurance facts we could have never known otherwise. But it's not only the word that's needed. Prayer is vital too. So Jesus says in verse number 9, I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. Now, somebody suggested that we should never pray for the world because Jesus refused to pray for it here. I pray not for the world, he said, but he's going to pray for it later in verses 21 and 23. He doesn't pray for it here only to continue his prayer for his disciples. Verse number 10, and all mine are thine and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now this illustrates beautifully, brethren, the loving concern that both the Father and the Son have for all who are theirs. They jointly possess us, and they jointly attend to us. But there's a tone of sadness in his words here, I am glorified in them. Think about it. Since he died for everybody, He should be glorified by everybody. But only in them is he glorified, or in those few there be that find it. Verse 11, and now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. And sensing the dangers ahead for those he'd leave in the world, he says, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. What a request that is, that they may be one as we are. Brethren, do you know what that suggests? To understand and consider this fact, the harmony in the Godhead is so flawless. Many fail to see them as three separate persons. It's just one of them, they say. Well, as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit all think and act as one, they all want their children to think and act as one. And notice, when the body of Christ is this unified, Jesus sees that as a chief means of its surviving in this world. And for which reason he prayed here, that they may be one as we are. All right, look again, please, at what he said at the start of the verse, and now I am no more in the world. You know, someday we'll say that too. And brethren, it'll be wonderful when we do. So long as we can also say what he also said here, that I come to thee. Verse number 12. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Though this thou gavest me, I have kept. So notice he had kept those to hear, who he asked his father in verse number 11 to keep from now on. And none of them is lost, but the son of perdition or Judas, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Such as Psalm 41:9 and Psalm 69:25. Now, for the record, these prophecies did not cause Judas to betray Jesus. But the fact that he would betray Jesus is what caused those prophecies to be written. All right, it's kind of worth noting by the wording here, those that thou gavest me, the Judas, like the others, have been given to Jesus by his father. Which definitely proves what? That, brethren, we can fall from the grace God gave us and that he wants us to have. Right, let me ask a little question here. Who is the only other person in the Bible given this infamous name, son of perdition? Who is it? The Antichrist. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 3. The word perdition means to destroy utterly, to perish. Verse 13, and now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. Wow. Is that inconceivable or what? He doesn't pray here that we'd merely have joy, but instead that we might have my joy, he says. And notice, not only present in them, but fulfilled in themselves. Which literally means he wants them bursting with his joy. Hallelujah. So what is Christ praying for here? Simply this, that we might experience, listen carefully, the exact same joy that he experienced. And brethren, since Christ's prayers always got answered, then this kind of joy has to be there for our taking. And by the way, how much do we need this joy, especially today? Look at verse 14. I have given them thy word, because they received it and kept it. As we saw in verses 6 and 8, the world hath hated them. Why? Because they are not of the world. But brethren, that's what the word does. It makes us unworldly. Just like the world, if it had our attention, would make us ungodly. So Jesus says that they are not of the world. In other words, while we're in it, we're not of it. And how much are we not of the world? Jesus answered, even as I am not of the world. Which literally means we're to live as separate from the world as Jesus did. There was a consequence for doing that, Jesus says here, that it will hate us, naturally, because we become a grief to it. We don't copy its behavior, we detest its behavior. So, it detests us. However, Jesus prays in verse 15, look at this, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. You know, an awful lot of Christians today want to gather in communes and escape the world. But it's not Jesus who encourages that. His will is to keep us in the world, while at the same time making us immune to its evil. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, for reasons I'll explain later, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. And brethren, God can do just that, and in fact, very supernaturally. Like he said to Ezekiel, I have made thy face stronger than their faces. All right, in verse 16, Jesus repeats what he said in verse 14. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. You know, there is so much stress in this prayer on making us separate from the world. It had to be one of the chief reasons for saving us in the first place. Remember, brethren, the world, the flesh, and the devil are our three arch enemies. And no more than the devil should be in our life, or our flesh should control our life, should the world influence our life. All right, please consider this. When a person is sanctified, it means they've been taken out of the world and set apart for God only. That's what it means to be sanctified. With that fact in mind, look at how Jesus tells us this is to be done in verse 17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Incredible. You know, the more we study the Bible, the more we find it's no ordinary book. I mean, look at this. Here, the living word, Jesus is telling us that the written word has the power to do what only he can do. Sanctify. Now, remember, sanctification isn't only positional, it's also progressive. In other words, though we were sanctified the moment Jesus saved us, nevertheless, we're being progressively sanctified today. And what's playing a major role in this daily sanctification? The Bible. How? Because like Jesus, it doesn't simply contain truth, but as Jesus says here, it is truth. And the more of its truth it puts in us, the more surely we become set apart for God. Remember, what Jesus does and teaches, the Bible declares. They both work together. All right, to see why Jesus wants us here in the world, look at verse 18. As thou hast sent me into the world to provide redemption, even so have I also sent them into the world to preach redemption, as verse 20 will make clear. So if we ever needed proof of how vital all of our ministries are, you've got it here, brethren. As God employed Jesus for his work, Jesus employed us for his work. Also, if the lost need proof that Christianity is the only true religion on earth, they have it here. While men fabricate religions, God the Father sent God the Son to provide Christianity. Verse 19, and for their sakes I sanctify myself, which you'll do through his death, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Which is all to say, if I don't die, they won't live. All right, to hear Jesus has prayed for himself and his disciples. And of course, much of that prayer could apply to us also. But look at what he prays for next in verse number 20, or who he prays for next in verse number 20. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. So here Jesus is praying directly for you. Which might be kind of nice to remember the next time you're going through a trial. That when Jesus was going through his trial, preparing for the cross, he prayed for you. He prayed for you. All right, now that he's prayed for the believers of all ages, look at what he prays for in verse 21. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee. That they also may be one in us. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. So again, Jesus takes our minds to an even deeper awareness of our relationship with God. I mean, look at this. We're no longer estranged from God like the lost are, but integrated with God so that our very persons are blended as one. I mean, look at this word again. That they all may be one, Jesus says, or perfectly united and harmonized as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, and they also may be one in us. Which pictures the Father in Christ, Christ in the Father, and we in them both. And for what purpose are we so interrelated with God that the world may believe by the witness of Christ in our lives that thou hast sent me? So as the world saw the Father in Jesus, it must also see Jesus in us. You know, while the lost despise our message, they cannot exist without it. So here Jesus prays also for the world, that it might receive a convincing message by our words and by our lives. Right, look at the amazing truth that's found in verse number 22. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. You know, your Bible in a few simple words can make a promise that dazzles your mind. I mean, for example, when it assures us that one day we're going to share Christ's throne in Revelations 3, that he's made us kings and priests unto God in Revelations 1, that we're going to judge angels and even the world in 1 Corinthians 6, and also that all things are ours, 1 Corinthians 3. Well, no less spectacular is the promise made to us here. Look at this. The glory which thou gavest me, Jesus says, I have given them. In other words, all of the infinite honors God the Father bestowed upon God the Son has bestowed upon us, his bride, who he shares everything with. Everything with. Romans 8:30 shows us how we progressed to this glory. Whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. And for what purpose did he glorify us? He tells us here in our verse, that they may be one even as we are one. Now for the record, being at one means to be at one in our doctrine, in our purpose, in our judgment, and not in every little opinion. In fact, as one said, that is neither possible nor necessary. All right, still concerned for the world and with a heavy heart for the lost, Jesus says this in verse 23, I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them. Which means that the lost will understand Christ's mission by seeing the effects that it has on our life. Notice that thou hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Now, Christ is placing a lot of emphasis on our living witness here, and well, he should. You know, the lost need to see how the love and unity of the church contrasts to the hatred and divisions of the world. When they do, they'll be more inclined to join the church. You know, Solomon said that the heaven, even the heaven of heavens, cannot contain God, which means that God is bigger than what appears to be an endless universe. So how big then is God? I don't know. But Jesus is telling us here how small he can become for our sakes. Look at this. He can live within us. Look at the first three words of the verse, I in them. Now how spectacular is that? Right, look at Christ's desire for us in verse 24. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am. Isn't that beautiful? So though we prayed that God wouldn't take us out of the world, he has no intentions of leaving us here. He's preparing us for his kingdom, and he wants us there with him. Commenting on this, MacDonald said that every time a believer dies, it is in a sense an answer to this prayer. If we realize this, it would be a comfort to us in our sorrow. All right, look what he prays for next. He wants his people with them, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. You know, Matthew Henry notes that Christ speaks here as if he did not count his own happiness complete unless he had his elect to share it with him. For it is the bringing of many sons to glory that makes the captain of our salvation perfect. Hebrews 2:10. Verse 25, O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, either directly or intellectually, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. So notice that Christ goes here from the world that doesn't know God at all, to himself, who knows him perfectly, to him who knows God personally as our Father and intellectually by his acts. As Jesus says here, these have known that thou hast sent me. Therefore, knowing this and Christ's mission, it becomes our mission to deliver this knowledge to the lost of the world. Verse 26, and I have declared unto them thy name and will declare it. And for what purpose? That the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them and I in them. You know, this chapter leaves us with two huge questions. One, could Jesus have possibly done more for us? And two, could he have possibly made us any more complete? You know, there are so many things we might want in this life, brethren. But look at just some of the things that God gave us in this chapter alone. Let me go back over it. Our oneness with the Godhead in verse number 9. The purest of truth in verse 17. The personal joys of Jesus in verse 13. The eternal glories of Jesus in verse 22. God in us in verse 23, and we in God in verse 21. And brethren, as if all of that wasn't enough, look at what could be even more astonishing. You don't want to miss this one. Look again at the last words of verse 23 again. Referring to God's love for us, Jesus says, and has loved them as thou hast loved me. In other words, with the same love that God loved Jesus, according to this, he loves you with the exact same love. To the same degree, he loves you. And listen, to show Christ's approval of this, look at what he prayed in verse 26, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them. Do you know what he's saying here? Father, to the extent you love me, love them. And what makes us eligible for such love as well as everything else God gives us? The last word of the prayer tells us, and I in them. Brethren, listen, when Christ comes into us, all that is his, he brings with him. God's love, God's glory, God's joy, God's everything. And what does he get in return? The last words of the prayer tell us, I in them. Matthew Henry says that when Jesus prayed that, he was saying, let me have this, and I desire no more. It is the glory of the Redeemer to dwell in his redeemed. It is his rest forever, and he has desired it. What a prayer. What a look at the heart of Jesus we have here. Commenting on this chapter, Marcus Rainsford writes that the whole prayer is a beautiful illustration of our blessed Lord's intercession at the right hand of God. Not a word against his people, the reference to their failings or to their shortcomings. No, he speaks of them only as they were in the Father's purpose, as an association with himself, and as the recipients of the fullness he came down from heaven to bestow upon them. All the Lord's particular petitions for his people relate to spiritual things, or have reference to heavenly blessings. The Lord does not ask riches for them, or honors, or worldly influence, or great preferments, but he does most earnestly pray that they may be kept from evil, separated from the world, qualified for duty, and brought home safely to heaven. Brethren, you know, when I was looking at this chapter, I couldn't help but to see how very intimate, how many times he kept saying, I and them and they and me. The intimacy of the relationship Christ wants with his people. You know, as you read a passage like this, how does your relationship with Jesus Christ measure up? You know, I always worked at my relationship with Christ, but after reading this, I felt I came up short of the mark. How about you? Do you know Jesus the way he wants you to know him? Are you as intimate with your Savior as he wants you to be? Are we as personal with him as he wants us to be? Do we live like we really know him? Not just know about him, but know him. Know him. So when we speak with him, we're speaking to him like a lover, a friend. Do we have that kind of relationship with Jesus? I mean, that relationship he's talking about here. Brethren, this morning, you know, we did this last week, or the week before last. I really think it's about time that we do it a little bit more. Pray concerning this relationship that we're supposed to have with our Lord. That one that qualifies us for all of his love and for all that he has planned for our futures. Brethren, if there's anything in your mind that even causes a doubt that maybe the relationship we have with Jesus isn't what it should be, why don't we resolve that this morning? Could we? Could we? Again, making it a time of prayer, even here at the altar, just praying, praying, praying that God will just touch our lives and give us that more meaningful relationship with his Son. Could we do it, brethren? Those of you who will, why don't you come down to the front? Those who want to stay there, just stay there and pray. But brethren, let's pray this morning, please, that we might come to know Jesus more intimately and more personally than we've ever known him before. Than we've ever known him before. Again, look at what he's giving us in this chapter, brethren, and how little he expects in return. The only thing he asked for was one thing, you. Not what's yours, all he wants is you to take up residence within you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Brethren, think about that, please. From the day Jesus was born on this earth to the moment he died, he kept giving, giving, giving. Everything that he had he gave to us. We who were poor became rich by him who was rich becoming poor for us and giving us all that was his. Giving us in exchange for our sin, his mercy, his grace, his love, everything. And all he asks in return is you. You. To take up residence in you. Brethren, really this moment, please open your heart to Jesus to the full and let him become everything that he wants to become in your life. Brethren, as you're praying, would you think about this, please? Someday our eyes are actually going to behold Jesus Christ. And when we do in that moment, we're not going to want to begin a relationship with Jesus. But in that moment, we're going to want to continue a relationship with Jesus that we've already had. Continue it. A blessed moment to begin in a tangible way that spiritual relationship that we have with him now. Brethren, pray to that end, that that relationship won't begin then, but begins now, so that we'll know him and the power of his resurrection, even the fellowship of his sufferings, even being made conformable to his death, death to ourself, death to all that we take up and allow to take residence in our life, that Christ might occupy us to the full. Brethren, all prophecy is fulfilled. Christ can come anytime. And as I've said so very many times in the past, if the rapture could occur any moment now, and it can, that means conceivably, think of this please, you and me could be standing before the judgment seat of Jesus Christ within the next 2 minutes. It'll be that quick when it happens, that quick. The rapture takes place in the twinkling of an eye, and from there we stand before the great judgment seat of Christ. Brethren, let's be sure and certain of our salvation. And once we have it, let us be sure and certain that Christ is Lord, that he floods and fills our life, and that our relationship with him is real. Real. So real. That, brethren, we desire him more than even unnecessary food. Conversation with him, time spent with him, the relationship with him. Brethren, let that be our chief goal. Whatever time we have left on this earth. And again, if anybody's raised their hand or you feel you mean it, make that deeper commitment, then do that this moment. If there's sin in the life, repent of it. If there's a need to open your heart even further than what you have to the oncoming Jesus, to let him into the full, then do that and allow Jesus to be what he wants to be in your life. Not what you want him to be, but what he wants to be in your life. Permit Jesus that privilege. He stands at the door and knocks. He will not barge entrance. But at the same time, he's wanting you to open up to him. Do that this moment, please. Remember, Jesus spoke to of those that God gave him out of the world. As we mentioned before, we can't be in Christ and in the world at the same time. A foot in both places, getting the best of both. It's not going to happen. We've got to come out of the world. Out of the world and what it has for us. And brethren, please, if there's that in your life, that's something that keeps pulling you back, making you look in the wrong places, think about the wrong things, and say things you shouldn't say and behave in ways you shouldn't, because it's the world in you, then brethren, just pray, God, help me come out of the world, to come out of the world, once and for all, forever. The world has nothing for us. It has nothing for its people. In fact, it is offering people more today than it's ever offered people before, ever, ever, ever. And yet, besides of all of that, I've got a question. If it's all together, put together to make them happy, then why is everybody today looking so sad? No smiles on their faces. Divorce courts are packed. People in all kinds of trouble. People turning to alcohol, to drugs, to things that they shouldn't be into, and seeking their solace in that, their comfort in that, their fulfillment in that. What a trade-off for Jesus. Christ wants to fill the life, and when he fills the life, there's no room for those things. Not even a little. Brethren, we've got to come out of the world to get into Jesus Christ. Just do that completely this morning, please. There's nothing like getting religion purely out of the mouth of Jesus, and that's what we saw this morning in the 17th chapter. And again, God gave us to Jesus after taking us out of the world. Brethren, could we all pray that prayer this morning, asking for more of Jesus? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning so very much for salvation. But God, what we seek most is more of Jesus, more of his will, more of his presence in our life, more of his word in our soul and in our conscience. God, more of Christ as our Lord, who knows how to get us to heaven and will keep us on that road. God, give us more of Jesus daily, so that God, what we have today won't be as much as we'll have tomorrow. God, make us, I pray, obsessed, absolutely fanatics for more of Christ, God. And God, I pray that you will wholly fill us, Father, with the presence of your Son, with the presence of yourself, God. As you make your abode in us, God, let us feel your presence. Let us indeed become your temple. Your temple, God. Walk in us and live in us. Be our God, and may we be your people. God, give us more of Jesus daily. More of Jesus daily, God, I pray. God, let us be obsessed with that quest. More of Christ. More of Christ. More of Christ. God, take what is justly yours, what you should have because you've died for it. Possess us, rule us, own us. Completely in Jesus, I pray. God, we just thank you for your word. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for Christ, who God is willing to lower himself to reside in us and be the captain and the king of our salvation. Thank you, God, so much for Jesus. So much for Jesus. Let us never take him for granted, never take it lightly, God, that you dwell in us, that we can commune with you, God, and that, God, more of you is to be had. Thank you, God, for your joys. Thank you for the glory that you've given us. Thank you for the presence of your Son within us. Thank you for the presence of yourself. And God, we thank you that we can even be so blessed as to be loved by you as you love your Son, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for all of the glory, God, that you gave Jesus, that in turn he has given to us. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you. God, I pray that you'll bless us. God, keep us mindful every day of our life of our need, God, for more of Christ. More of Christ. Let us not go backwards. Let us not allow Christ to subtract from our life. Let him be added on and added on and added on to his fullness, God. In his complete person, God, let us know him. Let us know him. As God, he resides in us as his redeemed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for living the life we could never live, dying the death we could never die, and paying the price, God, we could never together pay. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for who you are, for what you've done, and for everything, God, that you will do in our lives. Precious, precious Jesus. Precious, precious Jesus. Precious, precious Jesus. Precious Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.